Hi all, so let's get started. In our today's session, we would be starting with our Selenium introduction. So we're really learning about what Selenium is, how Selenium started, and we'll be learning about what are the different components of Selenium, what are the different flavors of Selenium, and we'll also learn about what testing is, what kind of testing does Selenium support, what are different types of applications you have, how manual testing works, how automation testing works, and pros, that is the advantages and the disadvantages of manual testing, and the advantages and disadvantages of Selenium as an automation tool. We'll also differentiate between some of the tools in the market and Selenium and what makes Selenium stand out and make it so popular in the industry. So Selenium is a web application automation tool. So it's an open source tool. It is very fast. It is reliable. Results are always consistent. Along with which, it supports multiple languages. Like it supports Java, it supports Python, it supports your Ruby, your Perl. It supports multiple platforms as well. Like it supports your operating systems like Windows, it supports Mac. We have Linux, we have Android operating systems that are supported. And it also supports your Unix, your Linux, and all possible flavors of your operating system. At the same time, it also supports different browsers. Where it name any browser that you have in the industry now, the support is given by your Selenium, like your Safari, your Opera, your Chrome, your Mozilla Firefox. So all browsers have been supported by your Selenium. Now, first of all, we start with understanding what are applications. What are applications? What do you mean by an application? So an application is a set of lines of code that we are going to write to achieve a coordinated functions or a task. So that is what an application is. So how many types of applications are there? So basically speaking, there are four different types of application. So one is your desktop application. The other one is your web applications. You have something called as your mobile applications, and we have something as your hybrid application. So what do you mean by a desktop application? It's an application which is installed on a standalone system or which is installed on a particular desktop or a laptop and which is actually dedicated to that particular system alone is known as your desktop application. Like you have your PowerPoint, you have your media players, or you have your office, your whole office software. There are so many applications that you installed on a particular machine, and once installed on it, only then you guys will be able to use it. And if it is installed on that particular machine alone, you should be able to access in that machine itself. So if you have to use it on a different machine, you'll have to reinstall it once again. So that kind of applications are called as your standalone applications, or you also call them as desktop applications. And what do you mean by a web application? A web application is something that runs over your browser. With the help of your internet, it requires a web browser to get launched and to get access. So such kind of applications are called as your web applications, like your Edureka, the one which we have, or your any of your shopping portals, like your Amazon, or your Selenium applications that you have. Any kind of applications that is accessed through a browser is known as your web application. Next, we have your mobile applications. So the name itself say anything that is designed to run on a mobile device is known as your mobile applications. Like even this is kind of a standalone, but it is installed on a mobile device. So like your music players, you have your Google Play, you have your messengers, you have your contact. So there are so many applications that you installed on your mobiles, your cameras. So these kind of applications are called as your mobile application. Now, the fourth type of application you have is a hybrid application. So what does it do? So this particular application is installed on a mobile device, but internally it uses a web browser in order to work with it. For example, say your Facebook app. So though you have a Facebook application that can be installed on your mobile devices, but internally or at the back end, it will still be using your web servers in order to collect the feed. So for example, your Gmail or your WhatsApp. So what do they do? So they have a mobile version of an application, so you're going to install it. So once you install it, do you find a mobile servers for them? So consider about a Facebook. So every second, there are lots and lots of feeds that gets generated. So what happens is, once you open a mobile version of your Facebook and you start scrolling through the feeds, you get the updated feed. Where are these feeds coming from? These feeds are coming from the web browser. So these applications, though they are installed on a mobile device, they still communicate using with your web servers in order to get the information. Those kind of applications are called as your hybrid application. So this is about your different types of applications that we have. Now, what are the different ways of testing an application? First of all, what do you mean by testing? What is testing? So you are going to identify the missing components or the missing requirement, or you might also identify a defect, or there will be a deviation from your actual requirement. So those are called as your defects or your bugs. So identifying these bugs and the missing components with respect to your actual requirement, or verifying whether an application meets or works as per the expectation or not, or identifying the correctness of the application is known as your testing. So now, what are the different types of software testing methods we have? How are you going to test an application? So if you ask a layman, there are two ways. One is your manual testing, the other one is your automation testing. So in manual testing, you have different types of testing again. So you have testing like functional and non-functional again. And along with which, you're also going to do this functional testing. Within your functional testing, you have your black box testing. You have your system testing, your integration testing. You have something like integration testing, white box testing. You do your unit testing, and then you perform your regression testing. And for your non-functional, your accessibility, usability, you test stress, load, you test something called as your compatibility testing, a cross-browser testing. There are a hell lot of testing technologies or methodologies that we use. But on a high level, we have two different types of testing, one being your manual testing and the other one is your automation testing. So what do you mean by manual testing? Testing an application manually is known as your manual testing. On the other hand side, if you use automation tool or if you use any tool to test your applications, then we call it as a automation testing. Now, how are you going to test application manually? So when you're testing an application manually, so there are a lot of steps that are involved. So what we do is we start with understanding the application first. What is the flow of your manual test? First, we start with the requirements collection. We are going to start understanding the software requirement specification document, which tells us what is the requirement that is there from a client or from an end user. After which, we start analyzing the SRS document and we come up with something called as your test scenario. So each test scenarios will have your test cases. We are going to derive test cases using your test scenarios. And for these test cases, we are going to set up test data, if any. We are going to set up the test data, after which we are going to start testing the application. So when I say test the application according to the test data, then we are going to inspect all the elements manually and we are going to perform operations on it manually. And we are going to check for its functionality, whether it is working as per the requirement or not. If it is not working as per the requirement, we are going to raise something called as your defects or your bugs. So again, which is going to go to your developers, they are going to pick it, they are going to check whether it is as per the requirement or not, and they are going to start with whatever measures that needs to be taken. If it is going to be fixed, they give it back to you and you're going to perform something called as your retesting. Once you're going to perform this retesting, then this is going to be decided that it is working as per the requirement or not again. And then you're going to generate a report and you're going to share it with your stakeholder. So this is a typical testing flow that happens in our real. So now, once you do this, what happens with this approach is, so for example, say you've been testing the application. I mean, it's like start of the application. You have started it initially. Now what happens is for the first release, so there's a release one and there's a part of your feature that has been implemented or it has been developed. Now, a typical mindset of a test engineer would be like, the more and more bugs you get, the more and more interesting the application would be. So the moment you stop getting bugs, you will have no interest in testing an application. Is there somebody who would like to test an application even if you don't get any bugs? Obviously not, because that is how, I mean, we train our mind. The more and more bugs you get, you feel like testing the application more and more, and you start putting in your more efforts and trying to get or trying to test the application from nooks and corners. So now what happens is, in the first release, a feature which has got implemented and you have tested the application manually, so there are bugs and you get it fixed. Now for the second release, you have another features which gets implemented. Now how is it going to work? You're going to perform something called as your regression testing. So what do you mean by regression testing here? So you're going to test the application, that is your newly added feature, along with the existing feature to make sure that the newly added feature or the code fix, whatever has been done, is not going to hamper or it's not going to break down the existing feature. So now we do the feature 2 plus the feature 1 testing. At this point, you have, for example, say here you had some 100 test cases, and here it becomes some 200 test cases. So you have tested the application. Obviously, there's an integration which has been done and you get a lot of bugs. So now the same thing keeps continuing. And for example, say 60% of your application has been developed and it is consistent. You have tested the application more rigorously and you get to know that the application is pretty stable now. So now at this point, for example, you have some 1,200 test cases that you will have to regression test it. So now what happens at this point is, whenever there's a new feature which gets added, you're going to do the 60% plus the newly added features testing. At this point, as a test engineer, you would have lost interest in testing that 60% of it because you've been testing it more rigorously. So now talking about the application testing. So what happens is, you would have lost interest in order to regression test it. So what happens? We tend to miss out on bugs. We know manual testing is boring. It is a tedious task. You know, because of testing the application again and again, we would have lost interest, because of which we tend to miss out on some bugs. We leak some bugs, which is error prone, and it is always not consistent. So these are the drawbacks of your manual testing. So for example, say any simple application for that matter will have around 1,000 to 2,000 test cases. If you have to regression test it, so don't you think we need more resources? So can a person test 1,000 to 2,000 test cases, so all by himself? Can a test engineer do that? So even if he's trying to do it, can you think about the time it takes? It is time consuming. So even if you spread it across, say, some 4 manual test engineers, how many test cases can you execute in a day manually? So it's always limited. A maximum of, again, it depends on the complexity of the test case. Again, it depends on how many test cases are involved, how many test steps are involved. Very good. So sometimes we might end up testing only 25 test cases per day if it's like a medium complexity one. Sometimes it can be 10 to 15 test cases per day if it has more test steps as well. Sometimes it can go up to 40 to 60. So it again depends on time and also the test steps that are involved. So now with this, can you think about testing 1,000 to 2,000 test cases and with 4 resources? On an average, even if you test 30 test cases per day, it is going to take a long time for us to test so many test cases. So at this point, there are some drawbacks of your manual testing. Most of the times it is going to be error prone because we lose interest and we leak some bugs. Again, you have to answer your stakeholders telling that why this particular bug was leaked and all those stuffs happen. So now what happens with your automation testing? How is your automation testing going to overcome the drawbacks of your manual testing? So all your regression test cases are going to be automated, so that you don't have to execute them again and again. So the only effort that is required is in setting up your regression test cases. You're going to create your regression test script. So initial setup is required for your testing. So apart from that, what happens once you automate it? It is going to take care of all your executions. So you can execute it any number of times and it doesn't get bored. Every time you execute it, the result is going to be consistent. It is not going to leak the bugs. It is always going to be consistent. And the report generation will be taken care by itself. because the tools have a lot of features where you can also generate the reports as well. So you need not manually create a report. It is going to create a report automatically so that you can share it with your stakeholder. So that is how your manual testing drawbacks will be overcome by your automation testing. If you see this, so there are some properties that we have considered. So from the time perspective, from the resource perspective, the reliability, regression testing, so the UI testing, the script execution, so all of these, so how your manual testing and your automation testing differ. So when you talk about your time, like we discussed, manual testing is always time consuming and automation testing is significantly faster. So if four resources take at least 4 days or 5 days to test some 500 test cases, your automation scripts is going to take just 1 hour to test the same test cases, provided if the test cases are ready. I'm talking about the repeated execution. So it is significantly faster. So now when you talk about the human resources, there is a huge dependency in your manual testing. But when it comes to your automation testing, we have very less dependence. So I'm talking about the reliability. So when you talk about the reliability, your manual testing is less reliable because they are not accurate all the time. But when you talk about the test automation, it is always consistent. Every time you run the script, you get the same result. And for regression testing, manual testing is not good and automation testing is the best approach. And whenever you want to do a frequent execution, of course, manual testing is not at all a suitable option and automation testing is the best suited option. But for your UI testing, we do have UI testing tools. When you talk about the proper look and feel of an application, the manual testing is going to be the best approach. But when you talk about your script execution, manual testing will not do any script execution and it is always going to be automated. So the next thing that we are going to discuss about is your benefits of your test automation. So we already know what are the benefits. There is cost reduction because we are going to reduce in the human resources and also the man hours that they are going to take. And then it is reusable, which is once framework or the test scripts are ready, you can use them again and again. And it is always faster and you need not sit in front of your system to check what your script is doing. It is always supports your unattended execution and it is 100% reliable because the results are always going to be consistent. So that is the benefit of your automation testing over your manual testing. Here again, maintaining regression test scripts is it easy from release to release when functionality overrides or descope. So maintenance is always there, Vishnu. So when you talk about, for example, say, there is a login page that has been automated and the functionality is never going to change. The functionality of your test case is like when you enter your username and your password, you click on your login button, this is going to take you to the home page. There is a landing page which has to be redirected to. But there are times where the page might change. I mean to say the elements on the page might change. So today it is username. Tomorrow it can be email address, or today it is like user ID, or tomorrow it can be username or email or whatever your phone number or whatever. So all you have to change is, as a part of maintenance, you're going to identify the web element again and you're going to make some changes to the existing script. So, or there are always times if that particular module itself has been descoped, then you're going to comment out all the, or you're going to remove all the test cases from that particular module. That is what you'll be doing. So there is a little of rework or whatever redo that we are supposed to do. But when compared to your manual testing, the maintenance of your regression test cases are much, much better. So the comparison is with your manual way of testing it and automating it. So the same thing has to be done in case of your manual testing as well. Today it is like username and tomorrow it is like email. So you're going to change your manual test cases as well accordingly. It's not that you're not going to maintain any document accordingly. So whenever there's some changes that happens in your application, even your manual test cases will also undergo a change. So the same thing happens to your automation scripts as well. Now, the next thing we are going to discuss about is the different types of testing that we have. The different types of testings we have is your functional testing and your non-functional testing. So when you talk about the functional testing, what do you mean by functional testing? we are going to test the functionality of an application. You're going to test whether the business logic behind the application has been implemented correctly or not. So your automation of your functional testing means writing the scripts in order to validate all your business logic and your functionality expected from the application. For example, say you have a text box. So for example, if it's an email box. Now, how are you going to test the functionality of an email button or an email text box? You're going to check whether it is taking the email address properly, whether there is an @ symbol that is being validated, and the domain name is proper, .com is provided. I mean to say all these domains are provided properly or not is what you're going to do. So that is the functionality of a particular text box. So likewise, you're going to test the whole applications for its functionality. And when you talk about your non-functional testing, so you're going to perform the non-business requirement of an application. For example, say your performance. It might be your database. It can be your security, a very, very important. It can be the ease of use, that is your usability, or it can also be the accessibility. Whether you check your application is compatible with different types of browsers, you do a compatibility testing or a cross-browser testing as well. So these requirements usually remain constant as per your software sites. So these are the two different types of testing we perform on an application. So when you talk about the phases of your testing, so we have divided into three different phases. One being your unit testing, the other one is your API testing, and the next one is your UI-based testing. So what do you do as a part of your unit testing? So these unit test cases are run during the development phase before you hand over the system to the testers for testing. So this unit testing is supposed to be done by the developers. So what they do is they're going to write a piece of code. Once they have written a piece of code, what are they going to do is before they give the application for us, they're going to perform something called as your unit testing, where they're going to see or where they're going to check themselves whether the application logic is correct or not. So once after the unit test pass, then they are going to hand it over to the tester. And there's another phase where you do a API testing. So what do you mean by an API? It is your application program interface. So these testing will be done during your integration phases. When you're trying to integrate two different modules and when you want to perform tests against it, you're going to have an API that is going to help you do that, and you're going to start testing this API, which is going to give you a response based on a request. So these target testing based on the request and the response on which the application is built. So there are different responses that you get from an API. So you're going to capture these responses and you're going to tell whether your application is behaving properly or not. And there's a third one, which is your UI-based testing. So this is exactly the test that you perform on your application. So during your execution phase, you check for business logic, the functionality of the application from the endpoint as well, and the look and feel of the application as well. So now, what are we going to do, or what are the different automation types that can be done is, so you can automate your unit testing as well. Like you have something called as your JUnit, you have something called as your TestNG. So these two are your automated unit testing tool. And for your automated API testing, you can use your SOAP UI tool. So that helps you to perform your automation of your APIs as well. And you have your automated GUI testing tool. So when you talk about the GUI testing, so consider the functionality of the application and the user interface of an application as well. So mostly your regression testing scenarios, you're going to use tools like your Test Complete and your Selenium as well. So now these are the different types of framework you have in order to test an application. What do you mean by a framework? So a framework is basically a set of guidelines that needs to be followed to create and design some test cases. So there is no hardcore rules. There's no rules that has been set up that you have to follow the same way or the same path. So these are just guidelines. You can modulate them according to your requirements again. So follow a set of guidelines so that it will help you to create, design, and maintain your test cases in an efficient way. It helps testers to use your resources more efficiently as well. So what are the different types of framework we have? The first one being your linear scripting, which is your record and playback functionality, which your Selenium also has. So you have your record and playback functionality with the help of your Selenium IDE, you can do it. So what you do here is, you're going to manually record each step in the application, and you're going to play them back again and again based on your requirement. And the second one called as your modular driven testing. So what you do here is you're going to divide the test scripts into different modules. So now each and every module, you're going to script them, wherein each and every module will be performing certain tasks according to your requirement. So you're going to create some test cases. For example, say if you have a login page. So you're going to call it as a login module, and you're going to create all the test cases based on or pertaining to that login module in one single package. So each and every, or one single class. So each and every module will be broken down, and all the test cases related to that module will be grouped together, and you're going to perform a modular driven testing. The next one you have is a data driven testing. So what happens here is the test data is segregated. So you're going to use external file. It can be a Excel sheet, it can be a JSON file, or you can create a text file or whatever file you want. You're going to create a separate test data document, and you're going to drive the data from that file using your scripts. So that kind of approach is called as your data driven testing. And the next one you have is your keyword driven testing. What do you mean by keyword driven testing? So what you do is you're going to identify some keywords from your test cases. For example, say launch the browser, navigate to the URL, right? These are the keywords that you're going to identify. Launch is a keyword, navigate is another keyword. And then you're going to click on a particular web element. So likewise, you will be identifying the keywords from your test steps, and you're going to create them as methods. So each one of the test step, I mean, the keyword that you have identified is going to be created as a method. And these methods are added inside your Excel sheets accordingly. I mean to say, you're going to drive the methods from your Excel sheets itself in the form of your data-driven testing. So that is known as your keyword. And then you talk about your hybrid test framework. So this hybrid test automation is a framework where you're going to combine more than two different types of framework. So you can combine either your keyword driven and your data driven. You can combine your keyword driven and your modular approach. You can combine your keyword, your modular, and your data driven approach. So likewise, you can mix a lot of combinations of your different types of framework, and we call them as hybrid driven test cases. So this is the hybrid framework. I mean, the hybrid framework is the one that is really used in the industry. So each one of them will help you to achieve a functionality. So all of them put together will give you a better and an efficient framework design technique. And the next one you have is your behavioral driven development, where your test cases are created in your simple English language. So what you do here is you have something called as your feature files. So the scenarios will be broken down into an easy step where you have three keywords: given, when, and then. So now what you do as a part of your behavioral driven development testing is, so you're going to write a requirement in such a way that, so given when I am a Gmail user, for example, when I try to enter my username and password and try to log in, then I should be landed on so-and-so page. So this is one of your requirements. So that is how, given when a condition is there, I mean, given when a requirement is there, when I perform some task, then this is what is supposed to happen. So this is how your behavioral driven framework helps you, so that you are going to create a test cases in the same format and you're going to execute them. Now, this is about your different types of test automation frameworks you have. And when you talk about the tools, you have n number of tools that perform the same task. So, I mean, the combination is too much. So, you have Selenium, you have IBM RFT, so you have Test Complete, you have QTP, you have SOAP UI, and you have APM. So, there are different test automation tools in the market. Like your Selenium helps you to perform your web application testing. Your RFT also helps you to perform your web application testing. Your Test Complete also helps you do that. Your SOAP UI here is for your API testing. Your QTP is for your desktop-based applications, that is your standalone applications. And your API is for your mobile application. So there are a hell lot of tools that are available in the industry. We are going to wind up today. Thank you. Bye-bye.